Lord, fill us with your hope. Teach us your hope. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You know, I really do like sometimes hearing like the ding, right? If I heard one, right? It was like, that's the prayer. You said it. Well, if you remember from last week, we pursued peace. And why did we pursue peace? We pursued it that we might be a gift lifted up to the Lord, that when he looks down on us, he would see his peace raining down in our lives. And I'll tell you, what a timely message. Would we agree? Because when we step into the Christmas season, sometimes we find ourselves in a week walking 50 miles.
Amen.
Ed gets that one because they were traveling around parks, walking literally 50 miles. And Judy. Or some of us had that busy work week because Thanksgiving had just passed and we entered into the chaos of we have the work that needs to be done. Or we may have just seen all that the world is in itself on a daily basis, in which it's quite good at throwing its concerns at us on top of all of the concerns that we already have ourselves. And is it not a good and beautiful thing that as we pursue this entire month to be the gift lifted up to Jesus, that when he looks down, when he opens the gift, right, and looks into our lives, that he finds the very things that he would hope to look upon. You know, one of Jesus' prayers, matter of factly, was, Father, I pray that your people would be made one, just as you and I are one. Did you know that that's what the Christmas bow is meant to represent? Bound together in the love of God. Maybe when you look at it, you'll look at it a little bit differently. Who wants this bow to help remember that message? Who did that? That gravitated towards somebody. I know. Raise your hand. Who wants the bow? Cindy? Okay. Judy, I'll get you one later. She just raised her hand a little faster than you. Like, right there. Right there. So have you ever looked at yourself that way? You are a gift. And I would be remiss to remind us that Jesus looks at us as a gift so valuable, that the reason he came onto this earth was to live and die for us, that he might have a relationship with us. And he has some good, and not just good, but wonderful things that he pours into our life, and that he desires to pour into our life. And all we have to do is just go like this. Just stop. Be in the still and in the quiet and just say, Lord, what do you mean to pour into me? As God pours into us, we know that his hope is that the things he pours in would be very evident in our lives, that they would become living in our hearts. And then what is living in our heart then also becomes the expression of everything that we are. That when God pours in his peace into our lives, now peace is expressed. When God pours his love into our lives, his love is magnified and multiplied and poured out through us because of what he's poured in. You know, what's really cool about our Lord is just how personal he makes himself. You don't have to guess at what he wants. You ever been there at Christmas time? I'm just gonna give my gift to this person the best shot at it that I can. I have no idea what they want, because there hasn't been enough time for conversations, because the year's been so busy. But I'm just gonna do my best at it. And I love how God makes it so clear and evident that in his word, he tells us very clearly what he would hope to see in our lives. One passage in scripture, matter of fact, Galatians 5:22, which you've heard before, the fruit of the Spirit, what are they? Love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness. There's another one there. There's more. Gentleness. Ooh, that's a good one. Self-control. These are the things that God desires when he looks upon us and the gift that we are and the gift that we can be, that these are the things present. I love it how easy he makes it for us. It's like, actually, for my wife, Joanne, she actually has an Amazon account, and all I have to do is go and click on her Amazon account, and she has this whole list of all the things that she wants for Christmas. Thank you, sweetheart. Yeah? I got to share this, too, speaking of gifts that we can give, and giving it with a knowing, right? My son, Christian, yesterday, he handed me a Dad, here's a coupon card. And he said, an early Merry Christmas. And I gotta open this up, because what I love most about this card is, sorry, it's just good. It's my son knows me quite well. And so the things that he wrote in here is, he just wrote Frisbee, because how much we love to toss the Frisbee together. And he wrote 1 mile run. This one I really like, 10 minute backpack is what he calls it. Chess, board game. This was the only one I was curious about. Laundry. I was like, I don't know if that one belongs to me, but I'll take it. I'll take it. On a day, I may need someone to fold my laundry. So, with the Lord, there is this beauty in knowing, right? I get to know what Joanne wants on her list because of Amazon, and Christian knows what I want because he knows me so well. The question for us this morning is, how well do we know our Lord and his word? In what his desires are for us to pour his spirit in, that we might live for him and be the gift that we can be. James, who was the brother of Jesus, writes these beautiful verses. First, verse 22, it says, prove yourselves doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves. And then he says this in verse 25. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a what?
Forgetful
hearer, but an effectual doer. This man shall be blessed in what he does. We got to draw our attention for a moment to those words, the forgetful hearer, because it is, and this is just a reality worth pointing out throughout the Christmas season, is that we can know what God wants, and we can read his word, and even have that knowledge, but how far in the forefront of our minds is that knowledge? Is it leading you at the front? God wants for our love, our lives, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. But we go into the world, and what do we see? too much of the time. We see the opposites, right? With love, you could exchange it for, my goodness, why is there so much hate? In joy, we could exchange that for, my goodness, why is there so much sorrow? Peace? Do we see that? Are you hearing this, church? And I'm hoping that you're hearing the Spirit in this too, especially the Holy Spirit that says, be mindful, my church, because the world is the opposite of these things. And therefore, since they're missing so much of it, who then can you be as the light of the world? As God's gift, walking on this earth to make his kingdom manifest in your very life for his glory and for his joy shining down. Thank you, Lord. You got me saying things this morning that I wasn't even planning, but you want us to hear them. Now we're going to hone in a little bit on a specific gift that we can give to our Lord, just like we did last week, of peace being a gift. And we lit its candle today, being hope. Hope. In a world filled with hopelessness, right now it needs God's hope. For he is our only hope. He is the world's only hope. Scripture says this, be strong. I'm hearing the Lord say, we need to say those words, just those two. Be strong. Say that with me. Be strong. Now say I'm strong. Be strong. Be strong. And let your heart take courage. All you who hope in the Lord. The psalmist also has this to write, I wait for the Lord. My soul does wait. And in his word do I hope. Psalm 71:14. But as for me, which are words which should be reminiscent of also what Joshua said, but as for me in my house, but as for me, I will hope continually, unceasingly, we could throw that word in there, and will praise thee yet what?
More and more.
Regardless of our circumstances, regardless of an enemy who wants to come against us and pull us out, because we have a God who is mighty, who draws us in. And when we are drawn in, he moves us into that place of, I will praise you yet more and more, because you are my hope, Lord. If we had nothing else, we have absolutely and everything more than we could ever need in all of that. That's an amen, church. Paul writes this in Romans 15:13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yes! That's another amen. We ought to be saying that a little bit today. The Lord has given us not just a hope, but the hope. Amen! And Paul's encouragement in this verse is, be filled with it. Not by your own power, mind you, because that's useless. But by the Holy Spirit's power living in you, that you would have conquering joy and conquering peace and conquering hope. Can we be strong?
Yes.
Yes. And especially in the Lord. Now, do you want to learn something cool today?
Yes.
Huh? Right? Okay. Like, a little gift here that I want to give to you that's beautiful here in this passage. Because Paul, just before he writes these words in Romans 15:13, I want to read them again. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't do this very often. I don't know what our church challenge was this week. Do that one. But here's another one. Memorize this verse. And then live into it. All right? I'm giving the call as much as shepherd can and being the pastor. Memorize this verse and live into it. I'm going to test some of you later. Be ready for it. You don't know who? I don't know who. But I do encourage you, especially as the Spirit leads you, grab a hold of that. So in this verse, Paul encourages the believers to be filled with hope. And what he does here, just before he gives this beautiful verse in Romans 15:13, is he quotes an incredible section of verses in Romans 15:9-12. Now let's just read these. Therefore, I will give praise to thee among the Gentiles, and I will sing to thy name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. And again Isaiah says, there shall come the root of Jesse, and he who arises to rule over the Gentiles. In him shall the Gentiles hope. Now, to help make this point, the Gentiles, if you don't know who the Gentiles are, is unless you're Jewish, you're a Gentile. And let me just add this. If you're Jewish, I'd really like to know that. I'd be very interested, you know. That's a side note, okay, not related to the sermon, but let me know, because I haven't asked, are you Jewish? It's like, cool! All right, I have this Messianic Jewish background. So, in this passage, that was a rabbit trail. Forgive me, Lord, you keep me focused, but I do still want to know if you're Jewish. All right. So in this small section right here, what Paul does actually is he cites four passages in unison. That's why you see the words again and again, right? That there were these prophetic words spoken thousands of years ago over the Gentiles of what the Lord would do. And so why does Paul cite these passages? He does it to prove how God has always intended both Gentiles and Jews to be in a position to glorify him, that they have been written in since history's time to say that my salvation and my hope is for everyone. It's for everyone. And not only does he cite these four passages, but it's key to point out that in the passages cited, there is the law, which is the first five books in the scripture in which Paul quotes out of. There is also the prophets, and there are the Psalms. And he also writes from some of the great Jewish leaders of the time, being Moses, David, and Isaiah. Now, this is very important to note, because it shows how God, even from the beginning, always had you and me in mind with his plans. Do you know that today? That even when you're sitting in this chair and where you are in this moment, you are where God wanted you to be in position to either hear his word to receive him, or you have already received him because it was in his plan to grant entry into the presence of the very living God, being nothing more than mortal man. That hope was expressed when the Lord gave his Son to the world, showing that salvation was not meant just for some people, but for all people, to include you and me, every one of us in this room today, and every person outside of this room. So our focus this morning is hope. And we have to ask the question, what is our hope? Is our hope set on the things of the world or on the things in which only come from God? In setting our hearts upon Him and everything that He will give to us in this Christmas season. Truth is that this is something that should just stop us in our tracks and move us into a posture of joy and praise before the Lord. Lifting up hallelujahs. We sang it earlier, right? I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah because God has welcomed me into the family because I live in His hope. It says in the Word that our God is a consuming fire. Have you ever read that verse? He is a consuming fire. And what His desire is, that as He sets us on fire, that any hopelessness would also be consumed in the presence of that fire. I want to just stop here for a moment because I want to take a moment to filter everything that we received today and just seek the Lord's direction in it now. One of the things that the Lord is wanting to give to us in this moment is this gift. And I hope that you're receiving it and what you're hearing in the witness this morning. That God, from before time began, planned to have us in His family and to hold on to Him as our hope. We probably get more than one or two Christmas gifts this morning. I ended up actually, I don't know how, getting like four letters from one kid. I haven't read them yet. Here's what I know is that they are a gift. And that gift is absolutely precious. Can't wait to go home and read them. And any card, I'm sure for all of us, that comes our way that says, I love you. And what we're hearing from the Lord right now is that message. Card, a gift. I love you. I chose you. And you have been filled with my hope. Now go you yourselves and be the living hope. Be living love. Be living joy. Be living peace. To close us into this, I got asked this question. Has anybody ever heard the song The Little Drummer Boy? Now some of you smile because you're like, yes, about 10,000 times. The Little Drummer Boy is it's my personal favorite of all of the Christmas songs out there. And before I say anything more about connecting us to this song and to the heart of the message, I think we just need to hear The Little Drummer Boy. So Becky, if you'll start that video. Joe, if you can hit the lights right here.
Little
Did you see it in that entire song, right? Not just a song being played, but a worship being lifted up and a hope clearly seen.
That's it.
So I ask you, you've heard Little Drummer Boy, but have you ever heard it that way? That's awesome. Now if you want to look at that one again, it's by King and Country. Is the name of the band, Little Drummer Boy. And as we watch, not just that, that wasn't a presentation, okay? That was worship. That was worship. And it was a worship in which it should be bubbling and exciting and moving us to a point right now of, I gotta worship. I gotta move and I gotta dance and I gotta sing because of the hope that is living in me. Now some of y'all might be saying, now it's time to sing. And you know what I say to you? Amen. But here is my encouragement in that singing, is that there is the singing of song and worship to the Lord, and then there is the expression of worship in our very lives. Not merely being hearers of the word, but doers of the word. Worship, worship, church, can begin now. And what my invitation and the Lord's invitation to all of us right now is, I know we want to move and we want to sing, but I want you to take that and move it into an expression of living it in your life. So we're not going to sing a song right now, but we are going to move forward now as we conclude in a posture of worship. That we would be the Lord's little drummer boy. Whatever gift he has given you, to lay before the king and play for him. Pa-rum, pum-pum-pum. So to honor him. Pa-rum, pum-pum-pum. That he might smile on you. Pa-rum, pum-pum. So Lord, let us go from here with the joy that we have, that we worship you, the King of glory and the God of all hope. And let us go out living for you, and let that be our worship expression this day. In the way that we love one another, in the way that we love the world for you, the way that we dive so deep into your hope that we could even drown in it, and the world would look upon it and say, where does this hope come from? Jesus, it comes from you, and we thank you for it. Be our living hope, and may we live, Lord, for your glory. And the church said,
amen.
Amen. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Therefore, let us go out and live faithful lives. God bless you. Now go and worship the Lord.